Kalorama, a Recorded Books High Bridge imprint, presents Let the People Rule: How Direct Democracy Can Meet the Populist Challenge by John G. Matsusaka. Read by Christopher Grove. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to figures and tables included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. More than two centuries ago, the founders of the United States launched an experiment to determine if ordinary people were capable of governing themselves. The results of that experiment have been immensely consequential for humankind, affirming the basic competence of common people and providing a powerful counterargument to those who would rule over others without their consent. That experiment continues to shape the modern world, and democracy has become the government of choice for free people across the globe. Yet today, many people feel that something has gone wrong, that government is drifting out of their control, its strings pulled by a shadowy elite. The people with these concerns are called populists, and their growing numbers are destabilizing the trajectory of many Western democracies and sending them off into uncharted waters. I wrote this book because I felt there was a view missing in contemporary discussions of populism and democracy, the view of the populists themselves. Public discussion of populism has been framed largely by elites who see it as an emotional reaction to changes in the world, an angry backlash, a temper tantrum that needs to be palliated. The populists' insistent complaint that government has drifted out of the people's control has been dismissed as a rationalization or simply ignored. As the book shows, however, the populists are onto something. There is good reason to believe that government has gradually slipped from popular control over the past century. I wanted to bring this view into the daylight and share the evidence that lends it credibility. Once we recognize that democracy is adrift, our entire approach to the challenge of populism changes. In the elite formulation, since the root problem is the excessive emotionality of the people, the solution is to transfer even more power from ordinary people, temperamental and irrational, to technocrats, judges, and other elites, cool-headed and analytic. They would address the shortcomings of democracy by having less democracy. Yet if the loss of popular control is not feeling but fact, a different tack is called for. I argue in this book that we should fix the problem by making government more democratic. To restore the connection between the people and government, let the people make more of the important public decisions themselves. Direct democracy. I am acutely aware that the idea of giving the people more power might seem counterintuitive to some listeners. Indeed, for those who were upset by the outcome of the Brexit referendum, or who disliked recent American referendums that legalized marijuana, allowed assisted suicide, or increased the minimum wage, it may seem absurd to turn over policy decisions to ordinary, potentially uninformed citizens. Of course, some listeners' intuitions may run the other way. They may find the idea of giving the people more of a voice an entirely natural extension of self-government. Either way, it is important to realize that those intuitions are simply that, intuitions. One of the book's goals is to sharpen and sometimes challenge those intuitions by exploring how referendums actually work in practice. Having been immersed in the study of direct democracy for three decades, and having examined it closely from many different angles, I have seen its good sides and its bad sides. Public discourse, however, tends to dwell primarily on the bad. Critics often cherry-pick the rich history of direct democracy, neglecting the broader picture of its successful operation in the United States and across the globe for a century or more. These criticisms of direct democracy tap into underlying apprehensions among Americans that I suspect stem from the fact that the United States is a global outlier, one of very few countries that has never held a national referendum, making it seem more far-fetched than it actually is. To allow interested listeners to form their own opinions, the chapters that follow describe what we know about direct democracy, its fascinating history, the rich scholarly literature about its use and influence, and a variety of evidence collected specifically for this book that will be new even to specialists. I have taken pains to describe everything in non-technical language, with technical details provided in footnotes for those listeners who want to see them. The book offers a path forward for democracy that is distinct from the ideologically driven solutions that are so common today. I have come to believe that our pervasive tendency to see the world through partisan lenses is a substantial part of our problem. The solutions advanced here resist placement on a conventional ideological spectrum. Giving the people more control of policy is not a liberal or conservative position, but an aspiration that spans the spectrum. Not everyone will reach the same conclusion about the merits of direct democracy, but I hope that by the end of this book it will seem, at the very least, like an idea worth more consideration than it has been given to date. Even better, I hope some might come to see referendums as a way to meet the challenges of populism and make our aspirations for self-government more of a reality. Democracy is drifting away from popular control, but we have the tools to bring it back. I have been thinking about these issues for several years, but the hard work on the book began in 2017 during a sabbatical at the University of Chicago's Stigler Center for the Study of the Economy and the State. I am grateful to Luigi Zingales, the center's director, for hosting my visit, for encouraging me to pursue the project, and generally twisting my arm to give a series of lectures in which I sketched out the framework of the book. My visit there was quite stimulating and led me to think more broadly about the questions that I originally anticipated. Discussions with faculty members and visiting scholars during my visit to the center were also important in developing my ideas. As I wrote the book, my colleagues at the University of Southern California were immensely helpful in allowing me to test-run arguments over lunch, coffee and dinner, and during workshops. No doubt they sometimes tired of hearing about it, but they never let on, and our wide-ranging discussions substantially sharpened the arguments. Many people informed my thinking, but I want to acknowledge by name several people who provided particularly helpful comments, discussions, or written feedback. Chris Berry, Odilon Camara, Janet King, Eckhart Kohler, Martin Levine, Anthony Orlando, Oz Ozbash, and Yanwei Wu. I received able research assistance from Artum Jukov and Elise Matsusaka. My editor at Princeton University Press, Bridget Flannery McCoy, made numerous contributions to every aspect of the manuscript: organization, structure, exposition, going well beyond the call of duty. I thought it was done when I gave her the first draft, but the version here is vastly different and, in my opinion, vastly superior due to her patient questions, comments, and calls for revision, more accessible, clearer, and stripped of superfluous digressions. Finally, my largest debt in this book is to my wife Gia. Not only did she provide the usual moral support that spouses are supposed to provide, but she read every chapter in detail and gave me extensive feedback. Her comments, informed by both her PhD training and her years of professional business experience, led to changes in the tone, orientation, and quality of the arguments in every chapter of the book. For her consistent support through the ups and downs, there was never any question but that I would dedicate this book to her. Introduction. Democracy is ordinary people governing themselves. This type of government is the best we know and has served us well for some time. Yet many today have the uneasy feeling that democracy is adrift, slowly slipping from popular control, carried by powerful undercurrents that we can only dimly perceive. In 2016, this long-simmering anxiety came to the surface in a string of unexpected populist election victories across the world. Donald Trump was elected President of the United States on a platform promising to drain the swamp. Democratic Socialist Bernie Sanders, running on a promise to make government work for everyone, not just the 1%, came close to taking the Democratic Party nomination from establishment favorite Hillary Clinton. British voters decided to leave the European Union. Populist parties did unexpectedly well in Austria, France, the Netherlands, and Poland. By 2018, populist parties controlled the government of 6 European countries and, through coalition agreements, had a hand in governing 6 others. While Trump and Sanders disagreed on just about every substantive policy, they shared a diagnosis about the root problem and what was needed to fix it. Our campaign is about representing the great majority of Americans, Republicans, Democrats, Independents, Conservatives, and Liberals, who read the newspaper or turn on the TV and don't hear anyone speaking for them. I declared my campaign for the presidency on the promise to give our government back to the people. Donald Trump. My hope is that when future historians look back and describe how our country moved forward into reversing the drift toward oligarchy and created a government which represents all the people and not just the few, they will note that, to a significant degree, that effort began with the political revolution of 2016. Bernie Sanders. Across the Atlantic, opponents of European integration sounded the same themes. The official slogan of the Brexit campaign was, "Take back control." As leading Brexiteer Nigel Farage saw it, "Because what the little people did, what the ordinary people did, what the people who have been oppressed over the last few years and seen their living standards go down, did. They rejected the multinationals, they rejected the merchant banks, they rejected big politics, and they said, actually, we want our country back. We want to be an independent, self-governing, normal nation." All of this rhetoric is textbook populism, an appeal to the people to take back their government from elites that have captured and subverted it. The identity of the elites varied with the speaker. For Trump, it was the swamp, a shadowy combination of government officials, lobbyists, media, and special interests entrenched in Washington, D.C. For Sanders, it was plutocrats and their corporate allies. In Europe, it was technocrats in Brussels and other supranational organizations. While the elites may have been different, the claim that the people were no longer in control was the same. This populist rhetoric was not conjured out of thin air. Politicians were retailing a message that voters already believed. Over the past 70 years, voters have grown increasingly skeptical about the responsiveness of government. Figure 1.1, based on the University of Michigan's long-running American National Election Studies, ANES, opinion survey, illustrates this trend. Since 1952, the ANES has asked people whether they agreed or disagreed with the statement, "People like me have no say in government." The figure shows the percentage of people who disagreed with the statement, and while there is some volatility, the downward trend is unmistakable. In 1952, only a small fraction of Americans felt left out by government. 87% of college-educated Americans disagreed with the statement, as did 65% of high school-educated Americans. Since then, public opinion has soured considerably. As of 2016, the worst year yet, only 35% of college-educated Americans and 25% of high school-educated Americans disagreed. We are now in a situation where a large majority of Americans, both more and less educated, believe they have no say in government. Disaffection is also high in Europe. A 2017 Gallup poll of the 27 European Union member states found that 57% of people had no confidence in their national government. Although Europe lacks a long-standing survey like the ANES, tracking public confidence in government, a major study of opinion in OECD, Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development Countries, combining a variety of different surveys, concluded that citizens in nearly all advanced industrial democracies have become increasingly skeptical toward politicians, political parties, and political institutions since the 1960s or 1970s, depending on the country. What explains the long downward slide in public confidence? Why do so many people feel they have lost control of the government? Two possible explanations dominate public debate. The economics view is that people are frustrated by the government's failure to shield them from economic dislocation caused by globalization, automation, and the changing demand for skills in the emerging information and technology industries. Looking at the United States, advocates of this view argue that the government has alienated ordinary Americans by catering to the economic winners, large financial institutions and big high-tech firms. Especially during the financial crisis when it bailed out big banks and corporations while watching impassively as ordinary people lost their jobs and homes. The cultural view is that people feel threatened by social and cultural changes associated with globalization and immigration, which they see as undermining their traditional beliefs and ways of life. The people do not see government as striving to stem the inflow of new people and ideas. To the contrary, they see it as actively promoting open borders, cultural change, and the importation of global social values. The debate between these two views is the subject of a rapidly growing, empirically sophisticated literature spanning economics, political science, and sociology. To assess the competing arguments, researchers look for statistical connections between support for populist candidates and a voter's exposure to economic or cultural shocks. For example, if a study shows that people who recently lost their jobs were more likely to vote for Trump, it supports the economics view. If it shows that people in communities with an influx of immigrants were more likely to vote for Brexit, it supports the cultural view. Both explanations enjoy some empirical support, but the literature shows no sign of converging to a consensus view, and neither explanation seems to account for the broader reality shown in Figure 1.1. The decline in public confidence is a long-running phenomenon, requiring a long-run explanation. It cannot be attributed primarily to recent economic shocks, such as the Great Recession, or recent surges in immigration. Moreover, both views see populism as a phenomenon involving less skilled and less educated citizens, which makes them hard to square with the fact that trust has deteriorated among both more and less educated people. If we want to understand the growth of populist sentiment, we need causes that have been at work for nearly a century and that affect citizens at all levels of education. One impediment to understanding, it seems to me, is the way this debate has been framed. When considering potential explanations, the one professed by the populists themselves has been largely ignored. The populists, as voiced by the politicians who represent them, say they are frustrated because the government is drifting out of their control and into the hands of elites. Yet contemporary discussion usually treats their words as a facade behind which hides the true explanation. The idea that the connection between the people and the government might be fraying, making the system less democratic, is dismissed out of hand. The first goal of this book is to take the populist argument on its own terms and seriously consider the possibility that government might well be slipping from popular control. Investigating this possibility leads down a variety of disciplinary paths into the terrain of political science, economics, history, and law, and involves examining published evidence as well as new data I have assembled specifically for this book. What emerges is a picture of the evolution of government over the past 100 years that lends support to populist claims. Stretching back a century, government in fact has become less responsive and less accountable to the people. A particularly intriguing part of the story is that loss of popular control came as an unintended consequence of a series of sensible changes in the structure of government. Disconnection has its roots in an increasingly complex world characterized by rapid technological change, globalization, and immense governments that citizens expect to address every important social and economic issue. To deal with these complications, governments have become increasingly reliant on experts to design and implement public policies. The heart of government was once the small group of elected legislators that passed the laws. It is now the immense technocratic bureaucracy that produces the flow of regulations that constitute most of what we call law today. The rise of the administrative state, which I chronicle in Chapter 1, has tilted the playing field in favor of corporations, industry groups, and other organized interests with the resources to monitor and influence bureaucratic decisions, while simultaneously making it difficult for ordinary citizens to understand and participate in the policy process. It has also empowered the unelected technocrats within the bureaucracies, giving them greater scope to pursue their personal policy interests. We cannot cure the problem simply by rewinding history and rolling back the administrative state. The factors driving the loss of control, growth of the administrative state, and reliance on experts were necessary responses to the growing complexity of the world. Reverting government to a simple pre-industrial form seems impossible and would be unwise in any case. To find a solution, we need to think in terms of augmenting existing institutions, adding tools that allow more popular control, while maintaining a central role for technocratic expertise. Nothing would bring policy more directly under popular control than allowing the people to choose the policies themselves. This can be accomplished by cutting out the middlemen that cause the disconnection in the first place and holding votes on policy issues. In other words, referendums. Referendums are the best known form of direct democracy, a term that contrasts with representative democracy, where the people's role is restricted to choosing their representatives. Referendums take many forms, from advisory votes called by governments, such as Brexit, to votes required by law, such as Ireland's vote on a constitutional amendment legalizing abortion, to votes on proposals drafted by citizens themselves, such as California's famous initiatives. All of these referendums are implemented through ballot propositions that give voters the option to indicate their position on a proposed law. The second goal of this book is to breathe new life into the old idea of using direct democracy to address the problem of democratic drift. During the populist and progressive eras a century ago, direct democracy featured prominently in public discussions. It was widely supported by civic leaders, journalists, academics, and leading politicians of both parties, including Presidents Theodore Roosevelt, Republican, and Woodrow Wilson, Democrat, as a way to restore popular control and curtail the power of special interests. From 1880 to 1920, states, cities, and towns across the country incorporated referendum procedures into their governing practices. As a result, the United States now makes extensive use of direct democracy at the state and local levels, more so than any other country except for Switzerland. At the state level, for example, Voters approve amendments to their state constitutions, vote on bond issues, repeal existing laws by petition referendum, and propose and approve new laws via the initiative process. At the local level, school districts in New York State hold votes on their annual budgets. Cities and counties in California require voter approval for tax increases. And cities and towns in Alaska, Arkansas, Kentucky, Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Texas vote on whether to permit liquor sales. All told, over 99% of Americans vote directly on laws in their state or local governments from time to time. The populist and progressive movements ran out of steam before referendums reached the national level, when the world plunged into the Great Depression and then World War II. This left the country with a rich culture of direct democracy at the state and local levels and a complete dearth of referendums at the national level. The direct democracy deficit at the national level is not for lack of public interest. According to a 2017 Pew Research Center survey, 2/3 of Americans back the idea of voting directly on major national issues to decide what becomes law. And other surveys show that a majority in every American state favors letting citizens propose and approve state laws by initiative. The United States today finds itself as one of a dwindling group of democracies in the undemocratic position of never having held a national vote on a policy issue. Elsewhere, countries are increasingly utilizing referendums as a way to gauge public opinion on important policy issues. Prominent recent examples were the United Kingdom's 2016 vote to leave the European Union, Colombia's 2016 vote against a peace treaty with the FARC militia, and Ireland's 2015 vote to legalize same-sex marriage, and 2018 vote to legalize abortion. The idea of voting on important national issues enjoys majority support in all regions of the world. Europe, 70%. Asia, 67%. Africa, 64%. Latin America, 62%. And the Middle East, 60%. Since 1980, a majority of countries in all regions have held at least one national referendum, with the proportion of countries reaching 90% in Europe, Latin America, and Africa. Some of these referendums were held by authoritarian regimes and cannot be considered genuine exercises in democracy. But it nevertheless remains the case that many democracies are consulting their people directly on important national issues. All of this suggests that expanding the use of direct democracy does not require a heroic leap of faith. People are used to voting on policy issues, and we have a rich history across the globe that provides lessons in how to do it right. Explaining more concretely how this might be done so as to reduce democratic drift and how to capture the potential benefits while mitigating the risks is the third and final goal of this book. Giving people more control over policy decisions is the main attraction of direct democracy, but not the only one. A comparison of abortion policy in the United States and Italy points out another potential benefit. Abortion is one of the most divisive issues in the United States. Yet often lost in the polarized debates is the fact that ordinary Americans take a centrist view on the issue. Unlike those on the extreme left who assert that abortion should be permitted in all cases, most Americans believe that abortion should be prohibited in some circumstances, such as to select the sex of the child. And unlike those on the extreme right who believe that abortion should be banned in all circumstances, most Americans believe that there are situations in which it should be allowed, such as rape or when the health of the mother is at risk. As such, abortion has the appearance of a normal policy issue that could be resolved through standard democratic processes. A sizable, moderate group would be amenable to development of nuanced policies that balance a woman's right to choose against the value of prenatal life. The United States appeared to be heading down the path of adopting nuanced policies in the 1960s and early 1970s. As public opinion evolved and individual states grappled with the issue, abortion had been largely outlawed throughout the country in the late 19th century. In 1967, Colorado became the first state to reconsider legalizing abortion in cases of rape, incest, or danger to the woman's health, followed by California, Oregon, and North Carolina. The state of Washington legalized early pregnancy abortions by referendum in 1970. The country seemed to be heading toward an equilibrium that would allow abortion in some circumstances and restrict it in others, with the lines drawn based on each state's distinct values, roughly consistent with public opinion. The political process, however, was short-circuited by the Supreme Court's Roe v. Wade decision in 1973. In that decision, the court declared that abortion was a fundamental right that could not be restricted in the first trimester, could be limited in the second trimester for reasonable health reasons, and could be prohibited entirely in the third trimester. As a matter of legal reasoning, the decision has been criticized as lacking a grounding in the text of the Constitution. More relevant for this discussion is the fact that it overrode the country's democratic processes with a judicial mandate. The court has been forced to return to the issue again and again over subsequent years to extend and elaborate its original decision, becoming the nation's de facto abortion policy maker. The backlash against Roe v. Wade was swift. It catalyzed the pro-life movement, leading to the formation of interest groups such as the Moral Majority. Legislators repeatedly tried to chip away at the right, and there were even isolated cases of bombings of abortion clinics. As time passed, the controversy spilled over to the Supreme Court nomination process, where a nominee's position on abortion became an unstated litmus test for both parties. The battle has gone on for more than 40 years, with no armistice in sight. Abortion has become one of the most divisive and emotional issues in American politics, and a leading cause of polarization in politics. Instead of letting the states work out the issue as public opinion gradually evolved, 9 unelected officials imposed a uniform policy on the entire country. Abortion is a cause and symbol of the ruination of American politics, observed celebrated political journalist Howard Fineman. It was the first shot in a culture war that has turned the two-party system into a fractured mess. It did not have to be this way. There was an alternative path in which the court left the issue to be worked out through the democratic process. It's not that the judgment was wrong, but it moved too far, too fast, reflected liberal Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, a strong supporter of abortion rights, who at the time of the decision was directing the American Civil Liberties Union's Women's Rights Project. My criticism of Roe is that it seemed to have stopped the momentum that was on the side of change. A counterexample to the American experience is Italy, a predominantly Catholic country with laws influenced by the values of the Catholic Church. As in the United States, abortion had been illegal in Italy for decades when public opinion began to shift toward a more permissive approach in the 1960s. In 1978, the Parliament approved a law that legalized abortion under a formula similar to the one adopted in Roe v. Wade. Political groups on the left and right organized to challenge the law, using the country's petition referendum process to call the national vote in 1981. The left-wing Radical Party proposed to strike language in the law that limited abortion access, in effect liberalizing abortion law. The right-wing Christian Democrats proposed to repeal the core of the law, in effect making abortion illegal except when the health of the mother was endangered. Voters soundly rejected both proposals, the first by a margin of 12% to 88%, and the second by a margin of 32% to 68%. The compromise policy, incorporated in the original law, thus prevailed. This appeared to settle the issue. Since then, abortion has receded as a point of contention in Italian politics. In contrast to the United States, Italy did not see the emergence of powerful interest groups dedicated to removing or defending abortion rights, nor did abortion policy become the locus of corrosive political polarization. Parties rarely seek electoral advantage by taking positions on the issue, and voters do not choose candidates hoping they will appoint judges to influence abortion law. It seems that most Italians, whether or not they agreed with the referendum outcome, recognized the decision's legitimacy, and it brought a semblance of closure to the issue. While some Americans believe that abortion is too contentious to resolve through the democratic process, the European experience suggests otherwise. Indeed, precisely the reverse may be true. The U.S. Supreme Court may have created contentiousness by short-circuiting the democratic process. As The Economist pointed out, it would be hard to design a way of legalizing abortion that could be better calculated to stir up controversy. By going down the legislative road, the Europeans managed to neutralize the debate. By relying on the hammer blow of a Supreme Court decision, the Americans institutionalized it. That Italy, a heavily Catholic country, voted to legalize abortion allays the fear that religious voters, or other majority groups, will trample individual rights if the issue is turned over to a popular vote. Referendum votes in Ireland, another Catholic nation, that legalized abortion, 2018, and same-sex marriage, 2015, reinforce this point. Referendum voters are more thoughtful and sophisticated than most people realize. The idea of addressing democratic drift by giving the people more power runs against an alternative view that would give the people less power and turn over more decision-making to non-elected technocrats. In his book, Technocracy in America, Parag Khanna goes so far as to hold up Singapore, a one-party authoritarian state with a reputation for technocratic efficiency, as a role model, asserting that America needs less of its own version of democracy, much less. Variations on this theme, usually coupled with skepticism about partisan politics and the capabilities of ordinary voters, are increasingly common in public discussions of democracy. A few months after the 2016 elections, I attended a conference of economists, lawyers, government officials, journalists, and activists. The conference was about competition policy, but the issue on everyone's mind was how to understand Brexit and Trump's win. The keynote speaker was an eminent scholar with a distinguished public service record. His remarks traced the populist backlash to the failure of elites over the past generation to understand and respond to the economic concerns of less educated workers who have been buffeted by globalization, automation, and the transition to a knowledge-based economy. After diagnosing the problem, he offered a solution. Elites in the policy community should do a better job of listening to and understanding the concerns of ordinary people. I found it a remarkable blind spot that he did not mention the other possibility, giving the people more of a voice in decisions. His operating assumption, which I suspect was shared by most people in the room, was that elites would continue to monopolize policy decisions. The only question was how they should do it better. While a worthy aspiration, expecting more responsive behavior from elites does not seem like a realistic approach to solving democratic drift. For one thing, we have reason to believe that political elites misunderstand the preferences of the people they ostensibly represent. a recent survey of empirical research concludes that political elites often make systematic and self-serving errors about voter preferences. Moreover, policy elites are a culturally distinct group, highly educated, white-collar professionals clustered in the coastal cities, compared with Americans living in flyover country. In a study of policy preferences, political scientist Morris Fiorina found, not only is the political class more extreme in its positions, but its priorities do not mirror those of the larger public. Even if elites were able to accurately perceive the interests and values of the rest of the country, to reflect those views would require them to suppress and act against their own preferences. Prioritizing the views of the general public over one's own opinion would be difficult for an open-minded person, but it is likely to be especially challenging for political elites because survey evidence tells us that they do not respect the judgment of ordinary people. A Pew Research Center survey asked government officials if Americans know enough about issues to form wise opinions about what should be done. A total of 47% of Congress members answered no. 77% of presidential appointees answered no. And an amazing 81% of civil servants answered no. It seems to me that relying on elites to be more conscientious and attentive to popular concerns comes close to hoping that men will be angels, which James Madison famously warned Americans 2 centuries ago was not a sound basis for government. More generally, the speaker's analysis reflects a common mindset among elites, that they should remain in control, but perform better. I want to explore the other possibility, the one that speaker missed, that shifting power to the people is a viable alternative to ever-increasing technocracy. The book is organized in 4 parts. In part 1, I look closely at the disconnection between ordinary people and policy, and describe the changes in American government over the past century that have contributed to a loss of popular control. I explain the rise of the administrative state, which has shifted policy decisions from elected legislators to unelected technocrats in the bureaucracies, the concurrent shift in policymaking to unelected judges, and the tendency of legislators to vote without regard to the preferences of their constituents. Part 2 introduces a potential solution, direct democracy. I describe how direct democracy is currently used in the United States and Europe, where it is most prevalent, as well as other regions of the world where it is thriving. I also correct some common misconceptions about referendums, especially that referendums represent a novel and untested practice, and that they lead to chaotic and turbulent policies. I then turn to the anomaly of the United States, which almost alone among advanced nations has never held a national referendum. I trace this back to misunderstandings about democracy during the founding era, and show how, often in response to populist surges, each succeeding generation of Americans has expanded the scope of democracy. Greater use of referendums would follow the time-tested path of updating American democracy to meet the needs of the times. In Part 3, I explore the pros and cons of direct democracy more systematically. I start by outlining a menu of concrete reform proposals, some easy to implement, national advisory notes, and others extremely difficult, allowing voters to initiate and approve constitutional amendments. To flesh out how direct democracy works in practice, I tell the story of 2 prominent and controversial ballot measures, California's Proposition 13 and the United Kingdom's Brexit referendum. With these cases in mind, I then lay out potential benefits associated with referendums as well as potential downsides. I give special attention to 3 issues that are particular causes of concern: Are voters up to the task of making important decisions? Will interest groups hijack the process? Does direct democracy threaten minority rights? Part 4 turns to the practicalities of making direct democracy work. Voters do not want to micromanage government. They only want to participate in select issues of particular importance. Corralling insights from previous chapters, I present a simple framework that highlights which issues should be put to a referendum and which should be left to representatives and bureaucrats. And because holding a referendum the wrong way can cause more problems than it solves, Brexit comes to mind, I draw together a set of practical suggestions for the proper design and execution of a referendum. Together, the chapters in Part 4 aim to show how we can make the most of direct democracy. The success of populist candidates and parties is an alarm sounding with increasing insistence across the globe. Whatever one thinks of the populist agenda, it is finding a receptive audience. That so many people believe government is failing to represent them should concern us all. The spread of populism is causing some to lose faith in government by the people. A growing collection of books and articles argues that the way to save democracy is to make it less democratic. Ordinary people do not appreciate the benefits they are receiving from existing policies, the argument goes, and their temperamentality is politically destabilizing. Our best hope is to turn over more decisions to technocrats whose disinterested expertise provides a more reliable means to advance the public good. This book argues that we should not give up so easily on the idea of ordinary people governing themselves. Instead, we should double down on democracy and give the people even more control. Previous generations of Americans did exactly this when they faced periods of rising populist sentiment, broadening democracy by extending suffrage to include persons without property, African Americans, Asian Americans, and women, replacing appointed with elected governors and senators, opening up candidate nominations to all voters, utilizing referendums at the state and local levels, and more. Referendums are a natural next step in the development of American democracy and offer a direct way to address core populist concerns. People around the world say they would like to vote more often on important national issues, and the evidence shows they are capable of doing so effectively. I find it remarkable that the United States, the country that pioneered democracy and proved that a government created and controlled by ordinary people could succeed, has never allowed its citizens to vote on a single national issue. While almost every other nation holds referendums to decide matters of national importance, ordinary Americans continue to be kept at a distance from the public issues that most affect their lives. I do not fully understand why this is the case. To be sure, those with power seldom give it up voluntarily, so there may be a self-interest among today's elite to retain its influence. But I like to think there is more to it, that many people have not recognized the opportunity that is available. The broadest goal of this book is to rectify this apparent knowledge gap in the hope that it will enhance public discussions about how to manage the challenges that animate populist sentiment. Our democracy is adrift, but there is a way to put it back on course. Part 1. Democracy Adrift. 1. Disconnected by the administrative state. In a 2017 speech, Supreme Court Justice Samuel Alito remarked that the vast majority of federal law is made in a way that is never mentioned in the Constitution. It is promulgated by unelected executive branch officials in the form of federal regulations. The result has been a massive shift of lawmaking from the elected representatives of the people to unelected bureaucrats. Justice Alito was referring to a phenomenon much discussed by law and public administration experts, now commonly referred to as the rise of the administrative state. The rise of the administrative state is a primary cause of the disconnection between public opinion and policy, and a growing concern across the political spectrum. To understand this disconnection, we need to start with a picture of how laws are made in the federal government. The states use the same process, with minor variations. The federal government consists of three branches: the legislative, Congress, which includes the House of Representatives and the Senate; the executive, the president and federal agencies like the Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, or the Food and Drug Administration, FDA, and the judicial, the Supreme Court and other lower courts. The people directly elect the members of Congress and, through the convoluted Electoral College system, select the president. Judges are appointed by the president with the Senate's concurrence. As originally envisioned in the Constitution, Congress would pass the laws, subject to a possible presidential veto that Congress could override with enough support. The president would administer the laws, and the courts would referee when disagreements arose in connection with the laws. For example, Congress would set the law determining the tariff rate on tea imports. The president, through customs officials that he appointed and managed, would collect the tariff revenue when the goods arrived at a port, and the courts would adjudicate disputes, such as when an importer and a customs official disagreed about whether the product imported met the definition of tea. Under this system, the laws are controlled by the people through their selection of members of Congress. As the government has expanded, the president's agents, those charged to help the president administer the laws, have multiplied. They are now scattered throughout numerous agencies, each of which focuses on enforcing a particular set of laws. The EPA monitors pollution and air and water quality. The FDA oversees the safety of new medical products. As these agencies have grown, the nature of their work has changed. Executive branch employees, once tasked to administer the laws, are now empowered to make the laws. For instance, Congress has ceased setting tariff rates and given the power instead to the executive branch. This shift of lawmaking authority from the legislative to the executive branch constitutes the most important change in policymaking from the founding of the nation to today. We have come to call this immense government bureaucracy with lawmaking power the administrative state. It is the central feature of modern government in every advanced democracy. The next task is to understand how and why the administrative agencies became the center of policymaking. Origins of the administrative state. For the first 100 years, the government ran essentially according to the original plan. Congress formulated and passed the laws, the president administered them, and the courts adjudicated disputes. The executive branch was small, with only a few cabinet-level agencies, initially just the Departments of War, the Navy, State, and the Treasury, later supplemented with the Departments of the Interior, Justice, and Post Office. In 1887, Congress created the first independent regulatory agency, the Interstate Commerce Commission, ICC, to regulate railroad rates and other railroad business practices. The move was a response to pressure from farmers and commercial shippers, who felt overcharged and exploited by railroads, and from the railroads themselves, who felt that competition had reached a ruinous level. In setting up the ICC, Congress departed from its past practices in two important ways. First, instead of specifying rates itself, Congress simply stated that rates must be reasonable and just, and left it up to the Commission to flesh out the details. Delegating this responsibility had significant advantages. It allowed experts to shape regulatory decisions and enabled more rapid adaptation to shifting market conditions than if Congress had played a hands-on role. Second, Congress gave the ICC some degree of independence from the president. Unlike traditional executive departments, where the head served at the president's pleasure, ICC commissioners could be removed by the president only because of inefficiency, neglect of duty, or malfeasance in office, not over policy differences. The ICC was followed by a host of new agencies over the subsequent half-century. During the Progressive Era, the FDA, originally Bureau of Chemistry, was set up to safeguard the purity of food and drugs. The Federal Trade Commission was created to promote fair trade practices and competition. The Federal Reserve System was empowered to regulate the banking system. And the Federal Communications Commission, originally Federal Radio Commission, was created to oversee radio and other telecommunications. The New Deal witnessed the creation of the Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC, to regulate securities markets, and the National Labor Relations Board to regulate collective bargaining and prevent unfair labor practices. As with the ICC, these agencies often were set up as partially independent of the president. These new agencies signaled an expansion of the government's responsibilities. Unlike traditional departments that were designed to carry out the government's business, such as collecting taxes, delivering the mail, or national defense, the new agencies were built to protect consumers and workers from economic forces that arose in the wake of industrialization, urbanization, and the emergence of what has been called a consumer culture. That Congress acted by creating agencies instead of regulating directly reflected a growing recognition that regulatory problems and solutions were complex enough to require expert engagement. Congress could state its broad goals in the enabling legislation, leaving it to those with technical expertise, technocrats, to develop the detailed implementation rules that Congress had neither the expertise nor time to produce on its own. These agencies can thus be seen as a response to the growing complexity of the American economy, as well as the expanding scope of the problems that government chose to address. In addition to creating these new agencies, Congress delegated more and more responsibilities to existing agencies. More on this later. The end result was that by the end of the 1930s, the locus of government decision-making had shifted from Congress to the agencies. After World War II came to an end, Congress took a close look at the sprawling administrative state it had constructed in a piecemeal fashion, and was not entirely happy with what it saw. The public had also soured on administrative agencies after exposure to the inefficiencies and arbitrariness of wartime agencies. In an attempt to rein in administrative discretion, Congress passed, by unanimous vote in both houses, the Administrative Procedure Act, APA of 1946, now seen as the fundamental charter of the U.S. administrative state. The APA brought a host of changes. It imposed complex procedures by which agencies were to propose and promulgate regulations, required transparency in the regulatory process, mandated an opportunity for public comment on proposed regulations, and provided a role for judges to oversee agency decisions, elaborated over time through a series of court decisions. Otherwise, it left agencies with substantial discretion to set policy. Another wave of agency building took place in the 1960s and early 1970s, as the country confronted a new set of economic and social problems, culminating in the presidency of Richard Nixon. Increased public concern with the damage caused by industrial pollution to the environment and public health led to the creation of the EPA in 1970. The emergence of an automobile culture led to the creation of the National Highway Transportation Safety Administration to monitor motor vehicle safety, also in 1970. Growing concern over workplace injuries and deaths led to the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSHA, in 1971. The proliferation of consumer products that were not covered by existing agencies, that is, products other than food, drugs, alcohol, tobacco, guns, and cars, prompted creation of the Consumer Product Safety Commission in 1972. The new century brought new crises, met once again with new agencies. After the terrorist attack on September 11, 2001, in an effort to provide a more coordinated approach to public safety inside the country, Congress created the Department of Homeland Security by combining 22 separate agencies into a single department. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, the newest agency, was created in 2010 in response to the financial crisis 3 years earlier to protect consumers from unfair practices by financial institutions. These agencies, like those that came before, reflected Congress's desire to frame basic policy approaches and directions for regulation, while leaving the implementation details to experts. A picture of the administrative state today. As of 2019, there were somewhere between 70 and 117 separate federal agencies, depending on how one defines an agency. Those agencies collectively employed about 1.4 million workers, not counting the Department of Defense, with more than 700,000 employees, and the Postal Service, about 500,000 employees. By way of comparison, in 1900, there were about 10 federal agencies with 15,000 civilian employees. Agencies administer the laws, in part by taking enforcement actions and in part by issuing rules and regulations. In 2016 alone, more than 97,000 pages were added to the Federal Register, the federal government's official journal, including 3,853 final rules and 2,391 proposed rules. The President also issued various executive orders and memorandums. In addition to rules and regulations, agencies often issue advisory letters, for example, the SEC's so-called no-action letters in response to requests from companies. Although these rules are not laws in the sense of acts passed by the legislature, most of them have the force of law, so for all practical purposes, are equivalent to laws. The volume of laws that emerges from executive agencies every year dwarfs the amount produced by the Congress. A close look at a few important issues that are now largely governed by executive agencies, or the executive directly, illustrates how decision-making authority has moved from Congress to the agencies. Environment. The nation's environment is protected by a series of laws enforced primarily by the EPA, but also by the Department of the Interior and Department of Agriculture. The EPA, an independent agency whose head is appointed by and can be removed by the President, was established in 1970 on the recommendation of President Richard Nixon, as mentioned before. Stripped down to its essentials, environmental regulation has two components. One, a list of contaminants that are considered unhealthy, and two, a set of standards governing emissions of the unhealthy contaminants. How much can be emitted, where, and under what conditions? Congress, in principle, could make both determinations. For example, it could declare that arsenic is harmful to health and prohibit coal mines from releasing more than a certain amount into nearby streams. Yet these sorts of determinations are complex. To determine how much, say, arsenic in drinking water is harmful to human health requires scientific knowledge concerning water systems, air systems, geology, chemistry, human health, industrial processes and technologies, and so forth. Rather than make these decisions itself, Congress has delegated them to the EPA. The EPA's authority comes from a series of laws concerning air, water, and land pollution, the Clean Air Act of 1970, considered the nation's first substantial environmental statute, instructs the EPA administrator to reduce air pollution that may endanger public health or welfare, but gives the administrator substantial discretion on how to go about this mission. To emphasize the delegation of authority, the Act states that the administrator is to identify pollution sources that, in his judgment, cause air pollution. And once he decides what counts as air pollution, he shall limit those emissions as he deems appropriate. Similarly, the Clean Water Act, the primary federal statute governing water quality, and the Safe Drinking Water Act call for the EPA to identify contaminants and set limits for emission of contaminants into navigable waters, groundwaters, underground waters, and drinking waters that, in the judgment of the administrator, would protect the public's health. All three acts run on for thousands of words, specifying in varying degrees of detail the sort of things that the EPA shall regulate, the processes by which it shall arrive at its regulations, and the sort of regulations that can be considered. But despite the details, the Act ultimately gives the EPA administrator broad discretion over implementation. The EPA defines what is to be considered a pollutant and what remedies are adequate. Congress has essentially told the EPA to protect the environment and left it up to the agency to determine exactly what that means and how to do it, in effect, delegating a substantial portion of its lawmaking power to the EPA. The scope of that power is incredibly broad. The number of activities that impact the air, water, and land is virtually unlimited. The charge to provide safe drinking water alone potentially extends from rules concerning drinking fountains in schools to purification standards in municipal water treatment plants to emissions from coal mines near mountain streams. Because so much lawmaking power is concentrated in the hands of a single administrator appointed by the president, policy can swing dramatically with a change in presidential administration, even if public opinion remains stable. For example, in 2015, President Barack Obama's EPA adopted the Clean Power Plan, which mandated a 32% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions of power plants by 2030, compared with 2005 levels. The Clean Power Act was considered Obama's signature climate change policy and hailed by supporters as a landmark law, but decried by opponents as unfairly requiring low- and middle-income workers to bear most of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.